vorhin wurde mir ein Video.
Hello and welcome.
Genau. Vorhin wurde mir ein Video in die Timeline gespült und ich muss da mal kurz reingucken. Ich muss da mal kurz reingucken, weil das ist, also, sagen wir mal so, das sieht schon sehr sportlich aus, was da präsentiert wird. Also, ich glaube, das ist das abgespacedeste Rig, was ich je gesehen habe. Und das würde ich mir jetzt gerne mal ansehen, weil das sieht wirklich schon sehr, sehr wild aus. Lass mal rein, Alan, hier.
Every once in a while, a rare opportunity comes along and you just get to sort of enjoy it. The other day, my parents were over and after dinner, I invited my dad to test the motion system. I'd drive in an F1 car around the Nürburgring until he got bored of it and then we would switch to something else. After I set him up and he was lapping,
Moment, was? Hat er zwei so eine Apparate im Keller stehen? Und ihr sagt zu mir schon, ich habe eine an der Schüssel. What?
Logged into the second sim to join him. My short list of things that I wanted to do before I die got a little bit shorter that day. A unique set of circumstances allowed me to do the impossible. I was racing with my dad, following him and eventually challenging him on an iconic racetrack in an impossible to own car. Lap after lap, I could see that he was getting quicker, and it wasn't until I saw an opening and passed him that I heard the metal of his pedal hit the floor and hear him mutter, "No." His engine dropped a gear and his car shot forward. With that sound, I heard my dad say, "Not on my watch," and the race was finally on. I've been waiting since April of this year to take delivery and test the Cubic QS S25 6 degree of freedom motion platform. It arrived about 7 months later, and it's clearly a significant addition to the studio. This is now the second Cubic motion system, and that lets me have a unique opportunity to do some comparative A to B testing. I have a rare opportunity to share with you because I don't have to guess how different they are, because I can simply tell you. I've also been inviting friends over to test both. This video should be seen as a summary of many.
Was ist in diesem Raum los? Hier hinten hängen zig Monitore. What the actual. Was zum Kuckuck?
Many months of feedback and observations from a wide range of user levels. The channel's known for no bullshit, and I have covered the theory and tangible training benefits, the things that Sims cannot recreate, and some negatives in a previous video, which is linked up for you right now. If you have not seen it, may I ask you to go watch it first as a preamble. It's not fully required, but it does cover in greater.
Okay, was lädt denn hier gerade was hoch? Lädt hier gerade irgendwas hoch? Ja, ja, ich habe Drop Frames. Gut. Let's go.
Detail some of the things that I'm going to speak about here. Videos like this are a huge monetary investment, plus it takes time to research, script, and photograph and produce. The video is not sponsored at all, and I have absolutely no affiliation with Cubic Systems, without any discount. I got the real customer experience, and with that out of the way, I'm going to cover technical information soon, but the video should start with why. Why I wanted such a piece of equipment like this. What
Alter, was ist denn in diesem Raum los? Alter.
Was trying to achieve with it, and had it fully satisfied my expectations. I'm a big fan of Sim, and I wanted Sim at this level in my studio. We should begin with driving. Driving is fully tactile because you're in contact with the surface for the majority of the time. It's as much about feeling as it is about sight and sound. You hold and feel the wheel. From the feeling, you get critical feedback from force feedback systems. The feedback tells you about the car and how much you can push it. If you feel this, and your opponent can't, it's to your advantage, but it's also about immersion. Adding appropriate motion is simply adding more feeling. And I use the word appropriate because a race car subjects the occupant to large forces and quick changes. I'm going to speak about cheap and weak motion systems later, but initially, with motion, you're distracted by the fact that you're being moved. It's new, and most people spend time observing how the platform reacts to their inputs. Humans test and humans are amazed by something that seems like it could be science fiction. But you quickly stop thinking about what the platform is doing, you look forward, and then you drive. You find a groove, and your lap times drop. You react quicker when the car is at the limit. I figured that motion would be detrimental to my lap times and my ability to be precise. If two drivers were racing on.
Maga, da stehen zwei Rigs, wo nur alleine das Motion-Zeug, also das große weiß ich nicht, was das kostet, wahrscheinlich 20.000 würde ich jetzt mal sagen, und das kleine sind 8. Alter, da stehen nur 28.000 grob über den Daumen gepeilt Motion in dem Raum, und dann haben wir noch nicht mal von dem Rest gesprochen, Alter, what the fuck?
Two different systems, one is static and one is being moved, you would make an assumption that the additional motion would hurt lap times, and initially, For a short time, this might be true. The driver will have to invest a short period of time to understand what the sim is telling them. Initially, you struggle to be competitive, just like before. Once you put down a couple laps, you become familiar with what the correct feedback is. You can exploit the extra senses and are able to perform despite being in motion. This early warning is strong, even if there's a little bit of lag, but when the motion is sharp, crisp, and accurate, it's rock solid. As I said, cheap motion is, in my opinion, worse than no motion at all. Conveying the gravity of the situation or the finer super details of the road texture requires a high-performance system. To convey how the tire is interacting with the road, on dirt, in the rain, on pavement, drifting, or even flying through the air, requires speed, power, and a system that can actually be violent. This fantastic experience I have in my studio also translates both to flight, either fixed or rotor. The same principles apply when the system is able to express how the turbulence are felt, the feeling of takeoff, and the correct feeling of finally being airborne at the end of the runway. When you deploy the landing gear, you feel the thump of the doors opening. The platform dips as you feel the drag on the airframe. You feel a huge thump when the gear locks into position, and everything seems to move a little bit less refined as your airframe is less aerodynamic. When you deploy the flaps at speed, you feel the vibration of the motors moving the flaps into position in your hands, in your legs, in your feet, in your back, and your butt. You sense the drag, the reduction in speed, and you feel the lift that's being achieved while you're trading airspeed. Deploy the speed brakes and you're slammed forward. You feel this right away and you feel it correctly with the correct force and the correct sharp motion. So moving from three axes from the PL220 to the six axes of the QSS25, these axes at work combine to let you feel slipping off a bank. It tells you when you need to apply a little bit more pedal. It tells you when you might need to relax the turn a little bit or when you should cut in a little bit sharper. I know I can fly better because of this, and I've witnessed novices, people with zero experience flying, picking it up quickly and enjoying my hobby for the first time. There's a lot.
Das ist so geil, Alter, dass da halt ein übelstes Rig steht und dann, naja, ihr wisst schon, was ich sagen möchte.
More drama and presence in theater, and it's so much more of a complex experience. It becomes so much more than just playing a game about airplanes. My time invested with it has made me work harder to learn the correct procedures, and my investment in the correct hardware that is more capable is paying off every single minute that I use it. Flying a helicopter in DCS is great with a great collective, pedals, and a cyclic. We tested adding 3 DOF, and now we're adding 6 DOF, and this once again adds a new dimension, or 3 specifically. I can feel the strain on the airframe in auto rotation. I feel when all of the forward speed has been checked before touching down with engines off. Touching down, I can feel if the aircraft is still or if it's about to drift and tip over. I'm able to correct for this and save the aircraft. Learning the timing over and over again here has allowed me to go well beyond my normal plateau. Without this sim at this level, my time invested was hit and miss. I'm more able to perform these maneuvers properly, and of course this is more satisfying. So, to this point, I've spoken about all of the benefits, and they are significant and tangible. I hope I was able to convey how well the system performs, but also it has operated flawlessly for hours and hours, doing exactly what I expected it to do silently. When I say silent, I mean people in the house are more likely to hear the pedals than the actuators at full speed. This is an added real benefit to the cubic system. I'm going to cover cost and what sort of considerations need to be addressed to prepare for this piece of equipment.
Yeah,
physically, it's large and impressive. People who have seen it in videos or photos still say the same thing when they see it. Wow. You will need at least 3x3 meters for it to sit in. Physically, it's large and very heavy with a dry weight of 650 kilograms, which is like 1,400 pounds or something. The studio is in the basement of my house with a tiled cement floor. It would be completely inappropriate to consider installing something like this anywhere but on a slab on the ground. No second.
What?
Or third floor rooms in your house, no condos, no apartments, a ground floor on a cement slab is ideal. It's rated to pull 17 amps peak at 120 volts. To prepare, I ran a dedicated circuit from the electrical box for a new plug. The new breaker, 10 meters of 12 by 3 gauge copper in a metal conduit clearly marked at the plug. And it says motion system only. They say you get what you pay for, and I'm going to say that this is more true with motion.
Maga, das ist aber auch einfach der Keller, Alter. Das ist der Keller, Alter.
Doing research for this, you'll probably find posts on Facebook with a person sitting in some kind of chair thing that's moving. They are not comparable to this in any way. Let me break down the cost because it's a factor of value. At the end of the video, if you're interested in planning for something like this for yourself, please contact me. I'm willing to help plan, import, ship, and then I fly to you and install over the weekend with my team. The QSS25 is sold.
Okay. Daher weht der Wind.
As a base plus options, the base kit is about $25,000 US, and with it you get the upper and lower frame, plus three pairs of actuators, each attached to a single control box and the software. Three brain boxes work with six legs in unison. It's really mesmerizing. The base kit is everything that you need to make a platform move. Adding $2,500 makes it actually usable with the cockpit set. You can consider the actual usable minimum to be $27,500. It includes some really beefy tie rod ends with extra side support and the wheel platform. The wheel platform is held in place and is very adjustable on eight additional tie rod style bars. The adjustment is quite the process actually, but it provides a great range of vertical, relief, and tilt adjustment. All of it is very big and beefy. I did some slight modifications to mount the Thrustmaster TCA yoke. There's more to sim than car, and it's nice that all of this can be used as part of it. The pedal mounting platform is the biggest component of this package. It extends below the seat as two red bars. The red bars run the full length of the floor, and it comes with a super solid deck plate. Above the deck plate is an adjustable pedal plate that can move closer or further and tilt on included hardware. Sometimes I do wish that there was another 10 degrees of tilt on this plate, based on what pedals are on it. There is also the most basic angled keyboard bracket that works very well with that Logitech wireless keyboard that we all have. There is a static seat bracket, a shifter bracket, and a place to hang a wheel or headset, and a set of steps. The steps aren't really an option. They should actually be included with the base kit and not the cockpit kit. The deck sits between 50 and 62 centimeters from the floor, and it would be very awkward to climb into this if the stairs weren't there. Beyond that main add-on, there are some others. I'm going to quickly run down the list indicating which were bought and which were not, and the reasons. For $400, I did add their power hub, which mounts to a metal plate attached to a distribution block. It's isolated on rubber. One switch to rule them all, there's a satisfying master power switch, and it also provides a common ground with beefy grounding straps, just for safety. For $900, I added their optional seat. As it turns out, that was a great idea, because despite having other car seats in the studio, the red bars become quite narrow, and nothing I had would actually fit there. I have since installed metal spacers to make it wider, and longer bolts to increase that space, and this allowed me to use the Sparco chair that I wanted originally. For $200, I also included their seat slider. It was pretty cheap, and because it rattled, I ended up replacing it with a higher quality one, but they had taken my feedback and said that as part of all future units, it would be replaced, so you shouldn't have to worry about that. There are two options that I didn't order. The first one is the $2,500 triple screen set and the $200 speaker mounting brackets. The speaker mounts were never needed because the plan from day one was to use a truly remarkable Macintosh RS250. Many might find using an audiophile grade speaker like this some kind of massive overkill. I'm going to say that clarity and volume are critical to seal immersion. The front mount...
Ich wollte gerade sagen, Alter, die Liste hört nicht auf und wir reden hier halt nicht von 100-Euro-Produkten, Alter.
...mounted Macintosh is in a direct line of sight with the occupant. This piece of kit is one of the cleanest and most powerful all-in-ones on the market. It's safely and securely mounted for a lifetime of service, it looks great as a centerpiece, and has enough range that you feel like you're in the car. With this next one, it's important to identify a polarizing debate and whether or not screens should move with the user. I'm not here to force my opinion onto anyone. It's fine for you to choose and implement anything you like, however you like. I'm going to say though, when choosing my setup, I knew that putting three 55-inch AA...
Also jetzt mal wirklich Butter bei den Fische, der FOF, der passt ja glaube ich mal gar nicht, oder? Ich muss mal kurz die FOF-Polizei spielen. Das haut ja gar nicht hin.
DJs on such a device that can turn quickly and constantly move beyond 1G would cause big issues. Imagine $10,000 of busted TVs all over the floor after the first drive. I chose fixed monitors securely planted to the floor. There are options in the software to compensate for this, plus you can disable motion blur and that shaky dash thing that happens, and you can do that in game options. So please consider when planning your own setup that there are more options than simply bolting screens to the motion platform. Shipping and delivery is an actual event that you should plan for. Shipped, it's 660 kilograms plus the weight of the crate. The box was 2x2x2 meters. Everything was packed safe, and things made it despite some superficial damage to the crate. The crate is there to get your parts to you safe, and mine did exactly what it was supposed to do. Unscrewing the top frees up the first.
Ich habe noch nie eine Lieferung gekriegt in einem holzverpackten Gehäuse. Noch niemals in meinem Leben, Alter. Also Palette, ja, aber.
Section. The parts are all laid out and separated in that space. By removing the first shelf, you have the base plate floor panels and some more smaller parts. By removing the second shelf, you have the rest of the base plate. The lowest section is large.
Ach, das muss man auch noch zusammenbauen?
Large and contains the 6 actuators, 3 control boxes, the upper frame, which is mostly assembled, and the chairs packed in there as well. I was able to carry all of the items myself, except for the actuators and the upper frame. With some help from my friend Kyle, we were able to negotiate the stairs without needing to disassemble the upper frame. And please note, the house has a 90-degree bend halfway down, so it is possible. Assembly was super simple. The base frame is comprised of 3 large and 3 small sections that are all bolted together. The base frame includes punch-outs for cable management. It includes 3 holes to attach 3 large casters for positioning. These casters are removed before operation, and the unit is far too heavy to move without them once it's assembled. The casters are there only for moving, and they must be removed before operating. They designed it safely because to use the wheels, you must actually remove the step, the power box, and a step plate. The wheels are a must, and I'm happy that they're part of the design. Once the parts were in the studio, the base
Alter, da steht doch noch was. Ey, was ist denn da unten
frame
los?
Was inverted on some of the shipping cardboard, and then using an 18-volt DeWalt impact and a crescent wrench, everything was tied together loosely and then torqued finally. Bolt, washer, lock washer, and a nylock nut to ensure that nothing will ever vibrate loose. I pre-positioned power wires, the safety interlock, and the Ethernet cable while it was inverted, and then flipped the base over onto its rubber feet. That part took about 90 minutes. Everything else required 2 people, so I attached the control box to the frame. Each actuator has 6 lower bolts, and this required that second person to prevent damage. Once it was all torqued down and checked, we lifted the top frame and attached it to the 6 actuators. The pedal support was attached, the seat was attached, pedals and wheels were attached, and then we were ready to test. Initially, we decided to test everything 10 centimeters further back so we could have full access to it and there would be no risk of things coming into contact with any of the TV screens. Each control box has a pair of switches that indicate what pair it is, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 6. The safety cut switch is wired into 1, and then it snakes over to 2, and then over to 3. The data is also sent in a similar fashion using a network cable. The PC is connected by USB to a small network adapter, and the software is very familiar as it's the same one that's used for the other motion system. Compared to any other I've tested, the software is super easy, very well planned out, and practically plug and play, which I do not not say lightly. It detects and pre-configures games that are installed to work with motion. Firmware and diagnostics are basically automatic. I want to say that when the system's off, the actuators relax, and it's important to say this when you're performing your final alignment and positioning. When relaxed, the upper mount is free to move where it wants, so you cannot rely on its idle position for alignment. The only true way to get everything perfect is to do what I did and use a laser level against the rear straight edge of the lower frame. After checking the grounding straps, the power cables, the safety switch, and the network, it was finally time for the moment of truth to see if we did everything right and if it would work. The system does a fun little startup routine for about 15 seconds to evaluate its idle position. It moves its legs just a little bit in a series of steps, and then it parks by pulling all of the actuators to zero and leveling out the platform at its lowest state. So this is already a long video, but I'm going to end with a lightning round and some final impressions. The system is very heavy and it remains where it's placed, but there was a situation with testing F1 2022 where we got to experience its true full potential. This thing is no joke and it can actually create forces so realistic and so intense that it did move. Because of this, it's shipped with a set of hard mounts that I will be using in the future. After drilling holes into cement, I will be securing the entire platform with lag bolts into the floor.
Na klar!
In the past video review for the smaller PL220, I said that it should only be used on a solid floor, a cement floor. As I said before, this is not an option with the QS S25. It must be on the ground, and as I said, I will be bolting mine safely into the cement. So this is the best motion system I've ever used that's designed for use in a house. It's large and expensive, but it still works very nicely in the basement of my house. It's super quiet when in operation, which means it won't ever disturb others. It's very well planned out. It's very high quality with pro level speed and pro level power. It was instantly clear that the additional axes, the additional speed.
Alter, das darfst du wahrscheinlich in der Wohnung nicht mal an eine Steckdose anschließen, Junge. Da knallt dir gleich der ganze Kasten durch.
And the longer range offer even more over the 3DOF system. Rather than tilting back when launching a rally car in dirt, you are actually thrust forward. Rather than being tilted left and right, you can be slid left and right. And most important, when drifting, sliding, or performing some kind of advanced flight curve in a plane or chopper, the additional axes, specifically being twisted about your center, matters, and that is the next level. The only time I've experienced a better sim wasn't a sim. It was live on a real racetrack. And now I can say, I'm not a pilot, but I fly helicopters whenever I want. I'm not a pilot, but I fly jets and planes whenever I want. And I'm not a rally driver, drifter, or racer, but I drive them all whenever I want. The more I play, the better I get, and of course this is satisfying and exciting, but it's also fun. It's the most fun I've ever had playing a game, ever. And because it's in my house, my friends, family, and I can pick a track or a runway, we can pick a car or plane, and experience something in some way not normally available or even possible. Until recently, this level of simulation may have been reserved for government, corporate use, or military use. It was inaccessible, and it's still very expensive, but it's available, and it's really, really, really good. Thank you very much for taking the time to hear my short story and my thoughts. I ask you to share with anyone or anywhere where this video might be on topic and interesting. Contact us directly if you want help with your own perfect sim, either in Discord or by email. Simulation may not be real, but this one got really close.
Ja gut, aber da musst du dann nochmal, wie viel waren das? 30.000? 30.000 war das, ne? Boah, alter Verwalter.
Hauptsache, er betoniert das ein, Alter. Er macht das Ding in Beton.
Da weißt du schon Bescheid. Holy moly, du. Das ist sportlich, du. Donation Goal? Maga, das kann ich hier gar nicht verbauen. Meine Nachbarn töten mich.